Hi, two boys in a sari. This is a lovely Instagram page. Hi, Sai Sojunya. Hi, Amara. Hi, Sojunya. How are you? So there's a friend of mine who will be joining for a Instagram live, so I'm just waiting for them. Hi. Thank you. Hi, Sariyu. Yeah. Again, lot of shit on my face, as usual. Hi, Sunil. So today we were having a call which was about to begin, but it's taking a bit of time. So I was thinking of by then, I would just come and interact with you guys. Hi, Tanu. How are you? It is my full look. Exactly. So we have to do something, you know. It's majorly like I'm so packed in this particular house. It's a new house which I bought, but still it's terrible and it's so packed. I can't stay inside anymore. Hi Sadhu, I'm doing good. Just going on. Hi Gautam. I think majorly we are so intimidated by staying inside the house. It's so required for us to come out as soon as possible. Or else if there is 10 or 15 days, my face will be disformed even more. Hi, Sajeev. So we're just waiting for a couple of friends to join. So until then, I was thinking of... Hi, Amir. Okay, so this is my complete look. So this is a friend of mine. No, I'm not performing. It was actually a call which we had, but we're just waiting for the other people to join. Till then, I will just make this person to sleep. Hi. You know, I look like Shri Devi sometimes. Khungat ki aad se dil bhar ka. No, I was kidding, sorry. She would be offended. Okay, so this is my disformed face. And don't ask me what I'm putting on my face. Okay, so how are you all, like what's happening? Okay, by the time somebody else joins, I will just add Sajeev. Sajeev, are you alive? Sorry, are you live? Like, are you okay to come on live? Indeed, indeed. I'm having hookah. Oh goodness. I'm so jealous of you. Hi.
Hi.
Yeah, now I'm able to see you. So what's up? We were waiting, and then I was like, okay, let's start it.
Right, girl, we gotta. Can you hear the music behind?
Yeah.
Okay, come on. That's my jam, girl. Okay, disco. Get me disco. So, what are we going to do over here? Do you have any idea?
Yeah. Let's start the conversation address and address. It's again morning. I'm not sure if you get any message. Okay, something. I got some kind of a message. I'm not sure what to read. You know, I can't read this way. Okay, let me just read it out for you.
Girl, I'm still putting my nails. Look, I just have one nails and one. Never mind. Okay. The bitch is always late. So she got nails and never mind nails. So I'm going to talk with my left hand today.
Yep.
Okay, let me lower the music down. Ooh, girl, am I looking good or am I looking good?
You know, I'm inside the ass of this particular person who is there on top of me.
Girl, bitch, you look fierce, okay? Thank you, Deepa. Thank you, darling. Hi. So, bitch, what you want to talk about? Yeah, yes, so I love it.
Yeah, we'll just talk about, because I think Adam's connection has been off. So that's the latest update which I had.
Sam.
I was thinking of... The Wi-Fi is gone. And I'm not sure when will my Wi-Fi want, because it's raining like extremely heavy. And I was like, let me go into the rains just like this and just get wet a bit.
Absolutely, Deepak. How can I forget? We had an amazing time. Looking forward for more. Which I love this. Like, whatever you're doing over there. Yes. Okay.
Look where the survivor looks.
Put a bunch of shit on face and be fierce.
Yeah. And these are wigs. You know, my tits are hairy.
I'm sure. All of this on my face is hairy too.
So yeah, let's talk about the thing which is coming up, which is Studio 69 and how... let's start from here. Like, when did you start drag and what were your initial inspirations?
I think everybody knows when I started drag. Now, I've talked about that enough number of times. I'm kidding. So, it was the summer of 1968.
Wow.
In New York City. When this bitch was walking on the streets and somebody held her hand and took her in. She said, bitch, you got the face.
Yeah.
No, girls. So yeah, it was when, you can say 2015, New York summer, 2015, I was going every Monday nights to watch my favorite queen in the city to watch her show, because I never missed her show. Mm-hmm. And by now, y'all know her name, Bob the Drag Queen.
Right.
So I asked her one day, like, Queen, would you be kind enough to help me out? Would you be my mother? Would you help me transform in this beauty? She said, mm-hmm. to my gagment, Would you? There's no such word as gag mint, but I will make one tonight. Gag mint. My gag mint. She said yes, and the bitch gagged. What? So that was the night. Then she took me, she called me over. She did all my makeup, transformed me into a totally different queen. And we went to a club. What's the name of the club? Industry Bar. Yep, that's Industry Bar, 52nd Street, 9th Avenue. Okay. And then she said, girl, do you have any number prepared? I might have you perform. I'm like, well, wait a minute, what? Me, the bitch you just met yesterday from India, who has no clue about these clubs, I'm about to perform in front of all these people in this bar with you? Ooh, now that's a dream come true. Not dream, dream. Now that's a dream come true. So here I was performing, doing what I wanted to always, just living my fantasy, living the life that I've always imagined to live. And that's how it all began. And after that, it was really no stopping. Like I really started to teach myself. I had to come back to India. I would practice. I would look horrible and a total mess. Oh, Lord. But when I went back, I was again practicing. A lot of people helped me along the way. A lot of my girlfriends, a lot of my queen friends, everybody helped along, and everybody helped build Gia. Well, before Gia was born, she was, oh my God, she was a Ronnie Bang Bang. Okay. Then she became Bibi Masala, Miss. Ooh, I need to lower down this phone a little bit. Can you see this? She was Miss Bibi Masala, honey. And then when I started voguing, he saw me, he's like, bitch, you giving me Gia. I'm like, who the fuck is Gia? What Gia are you talking about? Gia Khan? Gia Kapoor? I don't know. He told me about that movie called Gia. Listen, I went home and I watched that movie and I gagged one more time. Like, damn, I've done so much shit just like what she's done in the movie. Crazy. I was like, okay, now I get it. I will take it. And then Gia was born.
So I was thinking of, I would just share my journey as well, which is something.
Yes, honey, please. I want to leave that.
I think I started with a name called as Mohini,
Say it again.
Mohini Devi, Mohini.
Mohini. Ooh, come on,
Yeah,
Mohini.
but after a while, my body rejected the theme because it was not fitting in. I'm not that kind of Mohini and all. And I wanted to do something which is like this, putting up trash or which is called as animal drag. And I picked it up again. The style is something which is a postmodern approach for drag, and there are artists like Fade Up Ray is one of them, and then Justin Young's was doing a photo shoot on Tranimal, and Divine was the one who was endorsing Tranimal at that time. So I thought, like, just put the shit on your face and create something out of it. And that's how Suffocated Art Specimen was born. That's my name, Suffocated Art Specimen.
Right, because you do look suffocating, honey. You do look that you are gagging. You need air.
Exactly. I'm just catching my breath.
Right, you better catch
And
all of it because we don't want to see you passing
Okay, I'm seeing
Yeah.
a lot of messages. So that's how it started, and then I started developing or trying to create my looks and work on Tranimal and bring a kind of an Indian context to it, because in India nobody is doing Tranimal. We do have club kids, or we do have androgynous, but Tranimal is something which I was thinking of, picking it up and trying to learn and unlearn, trying to create a look which is quite similar to something which is inspired by animals. Animal
Right.
again comes from trans animal, which is one of the way of putting the transgender or transgenderism or the
Patuni,
idea of trans.
come closer to the camera. I think you're not audible to the audience.
Is it better now?
Oh, or you would want to be called as Sass.
Yeah, SAS is better. Yeah.
Okay, come on, Sass, get your ass close to the camera because we cannot hear your ass.
Yeah, is it still the same or is it better?
Is it better? Is it better, all the babies out there? I think so, darling. Carry on.
So that's how this thing started, the tournament started, and then I got some kind of inspiration to bring some kind of Indianness, like sometimes wearing a sari and putting a tournament outfit. The major thing is that tournament gives me kind of a way to escape of reality, like putting up a mask and not to show what I am as a person, but to show something which I can create or kind of, live in that kind of
Right.
a way. I'm just
So,
waiting.
for
Yeah.
yeah, check what is Mrs. Zara's situation, 'cause I don't know what she's up to. She's been in the news these days. Okay.
Yeah.
Our girl has been in the news.
I'm sweating.
I don't see. Okay, come on.
Thank you. So there's no update. Okay. Yeah.
I mean, I hope she's okay, though. Shoot.
So yeah, that's pretty much. And I really love the fact that drag has been an internal part of Vogue. Vogue has been an internal part of drag. I said it in the other way. And people majorly in India, when I started listening about the intersectionality of drag and Vogue or drag within other dance forms, there were only a couple of styles of dance which was having the intersectionality of both drag as well as the dance form closer to each other. One was Bhuto, which I practiced, which was majorly on which brings in that kind of ethos of drag, and the other one, especially seen from the Western context, was Vogue. Though I saw some of the videos of Vogue, it's I think it's a really surfaced style to put it onto the body because it has a lot of sitting and doing, which is just too hard. Even a trained classical dancer would not be able to because the format is so different, from what we see or what the other dancers are in India. So, what was the inspiration to start Vogue and tell us more about how is the scene or the Vogue scene in India in specific?
Honey, there isn't any scene in India right now, but we are in the process of creating the scene. I took a couple of workshops. I took one in Patna, darling. Okay, like though everybody gagged when they saw, like, bitch, you were teaching Vogue in Patna. I was like, bitch, people be learning. They
Right.
were, listen, they were going in. And I taught a workshop in New Delhi. I had a good response over there too. Like, what? 'Cause people don't really know much about the ballroom scene and the dance form itself, so yeah, it's going to take a little bit of time to introduce that to India, and thanks to pandemic, that bitch is stuck at home not doing anything. But I mean, I've thought of doing something online, but for me, if I want to really start teaching Vogue, like I want people to be there, like the presence, the vibe, like it has to be there, because Vogue, it's a lifestyle. The whole ballroom scene, the dance style, Vogue, it's a lifestyle. You can, I mean, you can teach the steps, and stuff online, but if you're trying to introduce the whole scene, if you're really trying to teach the essence of the dance form, like online is not enough. Like, I want people to be present, you know? And what else did you ask?
Yeah, so how did it start, and like what like especially within the context of India, are people aware about the form or not? You know, do they sometimes come and ask, you know, what is the form and all?
I mean, people are kind of aware. I think especially the people who are doing a lot of whacking, because it's a, you know, sister dance form, they are actually aware of voguing, what voguing is. But again, nobody really knows that how, you know, did it come from, where did it come, the kind of music, you know, the feeling, because it's again a street form and a club form, because the girls back then, like, they went to those underground clubs, all the people of color, the black, the African Americans, Latinos, all the people of color, they would go, especially, you know, gay and trans, they would go in clubs and just dance to the music. But yeah, formation of, so how did Vogue came into being? Vogue actually came into being in a jail. It was called Rikers Jail, honey. So Rikers Jail, people were practicing, and initially it was all about lines and poses. Because if you go search old school Vogue, you would see a lot of, you know, lines and bam, bam, you know, not, it's a little different from Vogue Femme that we are doing these days. So that's how it came to be. And then the whole house scene was coming up, because it was like a lot of things were happening simultaneously. You know what? Let me go from the beginning. Let me just restart the thing, because I feel jumbled in my own head. So back in the days, in the 70s, late 60s and 70s, there was a drag pageant used to happen a lot in America. And it was majorly dominated by the white gays, and there was a lot of racism. You know, our black girls, Latino girls, especially the dark skinned girls, they would not really get a chance. They would not win. You know, they would always be pushed back. So our mother, her name is Crystal Labejia. Remember that name. She was the one who started the first house in the ballroom scene, and that's how the ballroom scene began. So she went to this particular drag pageant. And there's also a movie about it. It's called The Queen 1968. It's on YouTube. You will see it. So she goes there, one of her friends, she tells her that, Crystal, don't go, you're not gonna get it. Exact words. And she's like, you know what, I will go anyways. So she went there and she didn't win. She literally walked off the stage, and the MC is like, Crystal, now is not the time to show the temperament. Get back on the stage, honey. She did not give no beep. And she said, I'm walking out. Honey, she walked out. And then you can see, you know, the camera going to the backstage, and Crystal is reading the winner to the filth. That's where this famous dialogue comes from. Darling, I don't say you don't look beautiful. I don't say you look beautiful, but I'm just saying that you don't look beautiful tonight. Look at your makeup. It is terrible. She reads her to the filth. And that was the point she said, you know what? Fuck you all. I'm gonna just go back and start my own shit. So then she started her own thing. She threw the first ball. It was only and only for the people of color. And that's how it began. So initially, you know, there were a lot of drag queens and trans women walking the ball. And then slowly, so if anybody has seen Paris is Burning, there's one MC that you would see again and again, would see, Shay, don't be shady, just be fierce. You would hear a lot of things. His name is Junior LaBeija, and he was the first butch queen to be inducted in a house, you know, and then in the ballroom scene. So slowly, you know, a lot of, because all these people were homeless, you know, they were thrown out of their own houses, abandoned by their blood families, and these queens would take these people home. You know, they would take care of them. They would give them food, you know, education, whatever they needed, and they would walk the balls with their mother. So the person who took them was known as the mother. So Crystal was the mother of the house of Labejia. And that's when slowly more butch queens, more categories, because ballroom became a safe space for all these people, you know, to live in their fantasy, to come as close as possible to the reality that they want to live. So they would have categories like a schoolboy realness, like people were not even going to school. Like at that time, I mean, it's still fucked up over there right now if you talk about racism and everything. But at that time, being black and gay, honey, it was, you literally have to wake up every day and just pray that, you know what, I hope that I make it through this day. You know, I hope nobody shoots me. I hope I'm alive today. It was that crazy. So ballroom gave them that safe space. And it also helped them understand that if you can be this fierce in the ballroom, honey, you can be fierce outside ballroom too, in the real life. You know, and when you go see the ballroom scene, there is everybody under one roof. You know, there are no internal phobias. Trans women, trans men, drag queens, femme, you know, butch queens, or straight looking boys, like we call them twisters, you know, who could pop, who could pass being straight. So everybody's under one roof. And that's was one of the really important things that really hit me. It's like, wow, everybody is so together. And while at ballroom again, honey, if anybody comes for ballroom,
I think I just got
stuck. So they're like so together that if anybody tries to come for ballroom girls, everybody stands together. They're like, bitch, no, you are not about to fuck with us. Like, that is not happening. So this...
And also, I think that, you know, because for our generation, like for us, you know, we're either not a part of the same country, and we, you know, somebody who are still struggling to bring in the kind of inclusion within our own country. I think the documentaries or the documentation of such things are really important, which always helps us in, you know, analyzing. I recollect recently watching this wonderful documentary on Netflix on Marsha, you know, Marsha P. Joseph.
Right.
And where, you know, the entire struggle was again being depicted in a really wonderful way. And kind of a reality check of where we are standing as of now. Same with Paris is Burning. You know, half of the information which we see on internet is something which is coming from RuPaul's Drag Race. But if we ask for the history, that's when we need to see, and you know, that becomes a kind of a source for reflecting the histories of you know, how exactly the drag has started, or you know, how exactly you know, things were there at that point in time.
Right. I mean, again, see, RuPaul, it's commercialized. They're not really giving you a lot of history, but they're definitely spreading the love of drag. And that is brilliant. Like, it's commendable where she has taken the art of drag. It is literally all over the world. So, but yeah, like, to really know the history, you really have to dig into the culture. You know, all these, you know, it's all these dances that we do, like we love to vac, we love to vogue, you know, hip hop, jazz funk, and dance hall, Afrobeats, you know, all these dance forms, and even the music, R&B, rap, jazz, rock and roll, it has so much history of the African American people, period. because that's where it really all comes from, you know, whether you want to believe or not. So if you are doing, if you're pursuing any of it, any of that, I feel it is your responsibility to really honor that history, the people, and the real music. Right. You know, like if you're really trying to do a dance form, like, yeah, you know, you can go ahead, do it in Bollywood, but when you're learning it, sweetheart. So I'm just going to cut it over there. My teacher, Tyrone Proctor, who I would always love, he was one of the original Soul Train dancers, and not a lot of people know about Soul Train, you know. Mm-hmm. So he always said, if you do not understand the music, you will never understand the dance. So okay. You need to understand that music, and then you can do, because even when I used to walk over there with the kids, you know, we used to say, if you call yourself a voguer, you should be able to vogue on any kind of music. Yes, but that's not how we started learning, you know, because when you're learning, you learn on those beats, because that was the music that created the dance form in the first place, from disco, exactly. House, and the old school house, not today's trance and techno and all of that. Some people like it, whatever, I don't. But yeah, you know, so that's where it comes from. So it
and
is.
I think just to add on a point, like I think, you know, like, especially the place which I'm coming from, majorly the classical dance background, for a really long time, the history of classical dance was always being covered. You know, because again, it's been taken from the Devadasi tradition, whereas it's not been. You know, it's not being acknowledged by the people who have taken it. And there was a huge debate. And now, after a certain point in time, we are trying to learn about, you know, speaking up with pride and speaking up about, you know, from where we have taken it and who should be the expert. Right. And this other thing which you have also quoted is something, you know, working for the music, or, you know, understanding the original music of it, which is really wonderful. Because, you know, nowadays we see a lot of, Bharatanatyam, and everything is coming in a lot of fusion techniques.
Right.
And I still remember this horrific, you know, video of this, you know, of a reality show where the two young, small kids are doing Bharatanatyam for a kind of, you know, for some kind of an idol song.
Right.
Which is both sexual and, you know, it's not a problem with sexuality or being sexual. But the major problem is like, you know, it was out of context. Hmm. And especially if the kids are doing it, it's out of context.
Because that was initially when Bharatanatyam used to be performed, it was performed in temples and also in the king's court. And it used to be a lot like they would dance in the circles because the audience would be all around them, you know. So even the state concept, it came much later after the colonialism and all of that. That's where we gained the stage thing and theater, because if you see there, like our street plays are so famous, like that's what we used to do in the streets, the street plays, the tamashas, and that's where dancing was also, even if it was temples, audience would be sitting all around. So you know, there's so much history that people miss, but again, if you really go and learn these classical forms from these schools, they will never teach you any of this form on any commercial music. They would teach you the talas, you know, they would make you recite it 100,000 times so you remember everything, you know. So when you don't, sorry, I'm going to just go back over there. When, you know, when you respect the classical forms, when this how you learn, so how can you miss respecting other dance forms? And just the entire music and an entire history, entire culture, you know, that's not fair. But yeah, coming back to you were saying.
Yeah. So, I agree on that as well. The reason why majorly they don't talk about it is because, you know, it came from, you know, it was being snatched. It's not something which is being given.
Right.
Something which was snatched out from the Devadasis, and you know, the system was abolished, And then this was being again, taken by the upper caste people and started, squelching it and calling it, giving it a kind of classical status and all that thing.
Right.
It also, it also needed that kind of a guilt within the people who are performing it. And that's one of the reasons why it's being hushed at a very, long time and quite often. But this generation people or this generation dancers are quite openly talking about it, which is a good thing. Like we are learning about the form itself, and also it's not the at times what we need to understand is it's the interest which automatically helps us learn the history of the art form. It's like if you're truly interested in one particular art form, you would automatically go ahead and get it practiced to, and you would yourself go and learn about it. So that's something which is really needed for this generation of people as well.
Yeah, it needs to come from within. But again, how will it come from within when, all you see is, people just following what is in. Everybody is just following what is in. Everybody's doing the same thing. Like I was just the other day I was talking to a friend of mine, and I'm like, these days, in every music, wherever like a fast 1, 2, 3, 4 beat comes, I see the same whacking move in. Oh, get something new, like chow. So I mean, it's because more it's become more of how we get likes or followers, and how much famous can we become. That's has
I think
become the
that's what is taking up the actual interest of an art form.
right. So if you're going to pursue something like that, then obviously you will remain in the commercial part of it. You would never really want to learn the original thing, the culture from where it came from, how it happened, and all of that, because you are not interested in it. You just want to make fame or money out of it. That's all you're interested in. So, coming back to our thing, that was the reason that we wanted to have something like this, Studio 69. So, Studio 16. So, it was a friend of mine and me, and I've spoken this with Adam too. I used to tell him about Studio 54, honey. That was a club. Ooh, I wish I was born in that time in the United States. I would be going in that club. It was just amazing music. People just were just coming there, enjoying the music and really dancing and letting themselves loose. It was all about that. And I feel that is something which is really missing. Because even in the club these days, I would see there'd be two people dancing, and the rest of them will be just
Sorry,
looking. I'm like, get the fuck out. So, I've always
had this.
and you could not really get into Studio 54 like that, honey. You would need an invitation. Look, I did my nails. Woohoo! While sitting and talking to you, now I am complete. I feel good. So yeah, so that was you could not just get in, like you had to be invited. Somebody would give you, okay, here you go, I need you in the club. So this is another thing on my mind, something like that. I'm like, you know what, once this thing has a physical manifestation, that's what I want to do. Have these parties, certain parties will be like, we'll be just going into different clubs or in class or whatever, and just picking up people that, yes, honey, I want you in my club because you are really dancing from over here, honey. I need you. So, something like that. And of course, Adam and I, we've been talking for the past couple of years that, and I told him that, you know what, we need more platforms in India, you know. Honey, we don't have even one full-fledged gay bar. Like,
Exactly.
you know, where you can go in the afternoon or you can go like early evening, catch a happy hour, have a drink with your friend. You know, there's nothing like that, or any full-time gay club for hosting something every single night. You know, I mean, of course, it's gonna take time. Like in New York, there are so many clubs, you know, and which gives so much platform to the local queens to really come and perform and express themselves. Excuse me, I need some water. And at least like three or four clubs have amateur drag going on, you know, like one is every Monday night, every Tuesday night, or every Wednesday night. So you have these different places where if you're a new and an amateur queen, you just need to show up one day with your music and everything done and just give them and go live your life. And you and get tipped, because people over there, they tip you. That's the first rule of a drag queen. A show, not even a show. Whenever you see a drag queen, you tip her. You see her performing, you tip her. You see her peeing in the bathroom, you tip her. You see her blowing somebody, tip her. You see her driving her car, tip her. You see her walking on the street, tip her. So, you know, I was like, we need more platforms, because right now we probably just have one like regular platform, you know. So we need more clubs, we need more spaces. So that was another reason for Studio 69 to begin, the major one. So the performances and the parties, basically just living your fantasy, because that's what we're missing. People are not able to live their fantasy. You know, people are still hiding, or they're still in their rooms trying to do whatever they can. But that's what we need. We need to open it up so they can go out and be in that music and just have fun, you know.
Right. And I think the reason how I got connected with Adam was actually hosting the Bangalore Pride when I was performing over there.
When? What?
2017, I was
Oh,
performing,
yeah.
for Bangalore 5, and it was then when we first met, and then a friend of mine, we got in touch, and we had this conversation about Dragon Tea and all the other stuff which we were doing. I really love the idea of alternative club, because that's something which is extremely needed, and especially for the drag style of mine, where it all the style is nothing. It's not performative. It's a performance art where you actually, the way how it started was so funny. It's like, there was a workshop which was being done by Dustin and Young, where he asked all the drag queens to come. There was a pile of trash which was there in front of him. He said, just pick up something and dress up something, whatever you want. And then the photo exhibition started. So that's how the carnival style has actually started. From there, people then started working on performances. Or what kind of performances would go with it, and kind of mixing performance art as well as drag together in a far more aesthetical way. So, however, that kind of that made a round of five or six drag queens who are being really famous for their animal, and then few of them who few of the RuPaul queen who adapted it and tried to present it as a part of the RuPaul the franchise. Like Evie Oddly is one of them. And then Sharon Needles, and now I think recently there was Crystal Meth, who had this avant-garde, drag style of them. So I think that's something which has been developed, and for a country to accept, or for a country to understand it, the first major thing which they need is more visibility or more performances. As and when the more we perform, the more we are in the public eye. That's when they would be able to go out and analyze and understand the art form.
Right.
That was really needed, because not every time a animal performer comes and does a dance number or a music number, but it's just like sometimes just coming and walking or
Right.
just staring at people constantly for hours and hours. So It need to be that kind of an alternative space. And sometimes the club scene works, and sometimes the club scene doesn't work.
Right.
You know, because, you know, when we have to pass a message with performance, we won't be going ahead and talking it in the club scene, but you know that one bottle will come and hit your head. So that's something which was really meaningful. And I love the idea of, you know, creating alternative spaces. And I thought, like, you know, that's something which we can bring into the table.
Yeah. Yeah, that actually makes sense. You know, it could be both. I mean, I think in today's time, it will be both. Because some of these queens are really doing some amazing work with virtual drag and presenting their, you know, presenting their work, presenting their looks with all these effects and background and makeup and everything. Yeah, definitely. But, you know, I'm an old school queen, so I would always love the cups. I want to go out, honey. Okay. With my nails, with my dress, with my pearls, or with my diamond. I just want to go out.
Wonderful. So, having said that, I think we have a plan which is coming up, and we both had conversations with Adam for a really long time, but we kept talking about doing a lot of things. You know, especially with 269, a series of performances which is being there on the plate, as well as a drag school. And I think I'm really excited for this particular project. You know, drag school is something which we have to bring it. A virtual school is now what we are planning on, like representing a kind of a master class for drag in India, and accordingly we'll be developing it with a far more better way of learning Vogue, because each and every time I go and listen to somebody from the West who's performing drag, especially, you know, the RuPaul queens, or also the small, little drag performer, Lactatia is the name, which I was seeing on YouTube, where, they are just 10 or 13 years of age and they're performing drag, and they come and tell me with a passion that, you know, I'm also having Vogue classes, so that, I can flex my body. So that's something which is a kind of a giveaway for all the artists that, you know, since that age, we need to ensure we take up our bodies in a proper way.
Yep.
And then we also can learn dance forms and, you know, try to connect it like Vogue. And especially in India, as we don't have much of, much of Vogue scene happening, it's really important for us to teach that, in a direct way with the learners. So that's something which would help us bridge the gap between, the audience, the learners, as well as the performers.
Right. Yeah, that is true. Well, I guess I don't know how long Miss Rona is going to stay. So I was thinking of, doing or giving a demo class, like coming Sunday. What is today? Today's Wednesday. So maybe like, I don't know, this Sunday or maybe next Sunday. So, you know, I might as well begin. So that's
and
one.
That thing. Would be really, wonderful to start with as well. And, the approach which I want majorly in Dragvanti as well, it's a free platform which I want to open it for every queen. So at any point in time, if there is anything which is there in anybody's mind, it's always, wonderful to get that thing happen. And you can always use the platform which is there for all of us and ensure that we are all connected.
Absolutely. So I want to see the whole thing. Is it like the whole thing that you've done, or?
Yeah, so give me one quick second. I just removed a bit of my, shirt because it was so tight and my arms were sweating. I just need to make it a bit flat.
Right. Today is Wednesday. Yes. You said Wednesday. Okay. Thank you. Yes, come on, girl. She better do it. Right, jiggle them out, girl. Jiggle them out.
The heritage.
Okay, she got hairy set of titties.
And this person on top of my head, one who has my head in line, this person is called is Dildo. This is the name
Ooh.
of my pet, which I keep it
Dildos are my best friends these days in this pandemic. Yes. So, are you like, what are you, what is this concept all about? Like, do you have anything in mind, or you would call it more
So I
abstract?
wanted to bring something like animalish. So this thing which I'm wearing is something which has a kind of a butterfly print. At the bottom is I'm wearing something which is a kind of a tiger print. And then this giraffe, which is again having a giraffe. And I'm just playing with prints which are there. And this one, this kind of a bug print which I wanted to bring
Yeah.
in. So
I
this
love
animal is like so funny. You just put something on your face, like half of the face is covered with fabrics like this, and what are the spaces which is available, or something like this and this, you just paint them.
Right.
So it gives a kind of a peel-off effect, or kind of some kind of an effect. I don't have anything specific. Like sometimes I go with the kind of looks, and sometimes I just see whatever things are available and try to analyze the pattern and see how exactly it turns out. Just randomly putting up, five or six things and trying to see if it's coming up. Sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes it just looks like it's too simple. I'm not feeling that much of suffocation risk. So I
Right.
ensure that I suffocate myself until the extent.
Oh, you into some nasty stuff. Okay, you like to get suffocated, bitch. I see you.
And other thing is like there's again similar kind of the animal side is majorly called as drag terrorism, but there's also a kind of a counterpart of drag terrorism which is done by the singer called Christine. So
Drag terrorism, you just said?
yeah,
Wow.
the reason is it's fucked drag in all the ways. So it's like
Well, I don't know
that's
about
one of the
drag
one of
terrorism, but let me just
yeah.
yuck. Hold on. Don't mind the background much, but.
I just now found out that the hard button just got.
Excuse me.
Yeah, I just now found out that the hard button just got blasted. Wow. I love that dress. And black is my favorite color.
Right, black is the color, honey. Black is the color. Yes, I love it. So, what time, how long have we been on live?
I think it's just 5 minutes for and do I think is somebody else live as well? Do you see that somebody else being live? Like Adam
Who's
is live
live? He's
on.
gonna go to somebody's live?
Yeah, is Adam live on the other channel?
Your channel? Are you talking about Dragvanti? Like, what are you? I'm confused.
No, in the Royal Campus.
Oh, is somebody online?
Yeah, I guess so, because that's the message which I have received.
Oh, so you want to finish this and then go to the 1927?
Yeah, let's just check it. If it's not, then you know I'm so suffocated, I just need to take this off. The ass is stinky over here.
How do I? Oh, so we're taking off, right?
Yeah. So give me one quick second. I will just confirm it in the WhatsApp. My video might be a bit. I see that it's not like nobody's online on the other side.
Nobody is online? Okay. Yeah. So I guess.
Hi, Avtari.
Huh?
Avtari Devi just joined.
Avtari Devi, hello. So you want to just end with just bopping around on the music and just slowly close down? Or sure. Do you have anything else to talk about? What you want to do,
yeah,
Miss Thing?
We can start with the music. We can just, we can just move around, and then I would just dismantle my face and bring it to another human being, which is there.
Can you hear it, honey?
Yeah. Adam just joined.
Huh?
Adam has
come
just joined.
Come on the wide campus. All right, girl. Let's go. Shoo.
Yeah. I think I just need to pack my space again. See you.
See you, darling. Mwah. And thank you, everybody, for watching us and listening to us.